Hello, everybody. It is 7:18 a.m. Central Time on Saturday, December 17th, 2016. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream. I've been in here all night, going on 24 hours, sipping on my coffee right now. Hope you guys are doing good, and I hope you're safe if you're in the West Pacific, if you're in the island nations anywhere in Papua New Guinea. Even on the coast of Australia, there's even some reports of some light to moderate shaking that was felt. That's going across social media on Twitter right now. I don't know how accurate that is, but, you know, those are Twitter reports. You can take them for what they are. But if you're not aware of what's going on, a 8.0 earthquake, 8.1 actually is where it started, now downgraded to 7.9, but still, the largest earthquake of the year, let's put it that way, has struck in Papua New Guinea. Now, I got to take you guys back 5 days to December 12th, and this is important. So if you're new here, I hope you listen up. I'm going to take you over to my YouTube page, and on my YouTube page, I've got an update from the 12th, and I'm just going to rewind this just a little bit. We'll take it back to like 17 minutes, and let's just take it back to like 1645. Now, just bear with me. You're going to hear my voice. This is my update from the 12th, and I'm talking about Papua New Guinea. On the 12th, I issued a warning for Papua New Guinea to watch for a larger earthquake than the 7.8 that hit this past week over in the Solomon Islands. And now here it is. Papua New Guinea just got hit on day 5 of the 5-day warning. But you better just hear it for yourself. Because I don't want to just explain myself. Let me mute myself right now so you can just hear my voice in the video from 5 days ago, okay? And then we'll get into the update. Now you're going to see another spot over here that's quiet, that hasn't moved. Spot that hasn't moved, I'm going to turn it down for the last week. Take a look. Notice anything standing out now, guys. We have a new silent zone here. Previous silent zone was here, where the 8.0 struck. And we issued our warning west of the triangular bend in the Solomon Islands for a 7.9. 7.9 hit. Now, here we are again. And now we have a new silent zone in Papua New Guinea. You see where our arrows point to? Okay, well, we have to watch in this spot for the next round of large activity to take place that's going to be bigger than the other earthquakes we're talking about down near New Zealand or over here just directly west. So in other words, there's a potential for a large earthquake to strike here in the next 5 days. Why 5 days? Well, when we're talking about large earthquakes, and we're talking about these deep earthquake events, every time there's a new deep earthquake, it adds more power to the punch of the final release. And I've noticed over the past several years that as these deep earthquakes happen back to back, it's almost like one sustains the other on in a relay race, passing the bar on to the next one. And until they actually finally stop, that's when the final pressure is released off these deep earthquakes. So it's an ongoing event right now, building and building and building, like pumping up a tire. Okay, it's each one of these deep earthquakes, a new pump onto the bottom of the plate. Eventually, it's going to get to the point over the next few days, and I'm going to give it several days for this to occur, for our new large earthquake, equal in size or similar in size to what struck over here at the Solomon Islands, which was itself a 7.8, 7.9. Actually, it was the largest earthquake of the year. It was an 8.0, but they downgraded it. So let's put it at 7.8. 7.8 to 7.9 potential is again in the West Pacific in the next 5 days due to these new deep earthquakes. Okay. So, that was me 5 days ago, issuing a 5-day warning and telling you guys to watch for up to a 7.9. And now you see it, they ultimately went with 7.9. Now, we're not just getting lucky, we're not just randomly guessing. The reason we looked for that is, like I said, that last round of deep earthquakes put the final punch like a jackhammer up on the bottom side of that already large movement. And it pushed it to the west. Now, it's a shallow, large earthquake, not accompanied by any other deep earthquake since. So that is good news. Okay, I've got some good news in all this. that there haven't been any new deep earthquakes. This spot that struck was our last warned location for a very large earthquake, and it hit on day 5 of the warning. So, what does that mean? It means the other areas are likely to be hit on the last day of their warnings as well. It seems to be taking a little bit of time. Okay, so, I mean, this is not shocking. Sometimes it's instant, within hours. Other times it takes days. In this case, it took 5 days. Let me get a sip of my coffee here. Hold on, guys. Okay, so, largest earthquake of the year has occurred. There is some tsunami activity. Do not rely on the U.S. agencies to give you that tsunami information, guys. Unfortunately, I'm going to show you something here, and this was a troubling thing for me to learn today. I came over to the tsunami site as the earthquake struck, and of course, you see all green, and it says no warning, advisory, threat, or watch. Okay, well, you might say, all right, well, that's, you know, some people say, oh, that's just for the U.S. Okay, well, you might say that, but we can go look up the Pacific Tsunami Warning Center that's tasked with warning for tsunamis anywhere in the Pacific. And you'll see that they've been playing around with this, but this has never changed from green. Even though they issued a warning for potential hazardous waves down in Papua New Guinea. Now, I've already clicked on that. Here's one of the warnings right there. Here's their final threat message for the Pacific. Okay, so we're going to read this. We'll click to read. This is the most recent. Message number 4. Okay, information only in support of the UNESCO IOC Pacific Tsunami Warning and Mitigation System. We'll need to check that one next. I'm going to copy that right now, and we'll go look that up next. But, and is meant for national authorities in each country of that system. Okay, so they have it listed at 7.9. And they say it occurred in the preliminary area, blah, blah, blah. Then we get down to the actual updated threat. Okay, the tsunami threat has now largely passed. Government agencies responsible for any impacted coastal areas should monitor conditions at the coast to determine if and when it is safe to resume normal activities. Tsunami observations. Okay. Tsunami height, 0.3 feet. 0.3 feet. Okay. All right, that's nothing. Okay, so the tsunami that was generated was absolutely next to nothing on that. 0.3 feet is what they're talking about. So the potential damaging tsunami, I dare say the threat of that has passed. Okay, that's good news. So we can take the tsunami threat out of there pretty much and now just focus on the earthquake activity. So the 7.9 that we're talking about here, largest earthquake of the year, going up by 0.1 from the largest earthquakes that struck previously to this, which was the 7.8 that hit in the Solomon Islands and the 7.8 at the start of the year over here at Ecuador. So there were some previous large earthquakes this year, but this one now beats them all out right here towards the end of the year. And I'd like to point out a few things about here at the end of the year. It seems that Earth works in cycles. I don't think anybody would be shocked to find out that seismic systems also work in cycles. We've noticed, and I'm not the only one who's noticed this, that around the winter time, about the time of, I don't want to get any kind of mystical here, but just in coincidental, around the time of winter solstice, just to give you that general time frame, okay, around the time of Christmas time. I don't want to say that either because people will read too much into either of those. But I'm just saying, in the winter time, we start to see an increase in earthquake activity. Let me give you some examples. The New Madrid seismic zone earthquake. The Great New Madrid earthquake in the middle of winter in 1811. Middle of winter. What is it, like January and February? Okay. The Great Boxing Day earthquake that caused the tsunami over here at Sumatra, Indonesia. All right, that's another example. We saw earthquakes on Christmas, multiple locations, and at New Year's. New Year's, Japan was struck 1 year at literally on New Year's Eve, like right at midnight, and I mean it was right at midnight, Greenwich Mean Time, there was a near 7.0 earthquake that struck in Japan in the megaquake location. Very strange. And New Year's, 1 year after the earthquake, the big one. So, I mean, they seem to happen more towards the winter than they do in the summer. Let's go back to the summer. Let's go back on the live stream. Everybody who's been here for the last 6 months knows you were here from the end of spring, throughout the summer, throughout the fall, now going into winter. We're going on 7.5 to 8 months of doing the live stream. And we've reached millions of people, by the way. But you guys have been here since the start. So you got to see it across the summer. You remember when it went into a lull and there weren't any 7.0 earthquakes for about 2 months? That's not a coincidence. That seems to happen on a yearly basis. As we go into the winter months, we start to see a pickup in earthquake activity. It's a very, very strange phenomenon. One that could be scientifically explained by a plasma core, by the way, and by a shift in the axis somewhat that would perturb the magma in the mantle. Slight shift in the way the Earth is facing or the distance from the sun or the pole angle to the sun, that could shift a magnetic angle and, of course, cause a perturbance. And that could happen on a yearly cycle. Makes sense, right? I mean, especially over here in the West Pacific. I mean, the chances of getting the two largest earthquakes of the year within this week, within the last, let's just say last week, last 7 days, and over here in the West Pacific, at the time of Christmas? Doesn't that sound familiar? Didn't that happen in 2004 and 2006 and 2007 and 2008 and 2009 and 2010? Didn't it happen almost every single year? Yeah, it sure did. And then when I picked up monitoring this stuff, starting at the end of 2010, it was really picking up in the West Pacific. And by March of 2011, that's when the Japan megaquake happened. And then the summer months hit, and it started to quiet out over the summer. And we got back into the winter, and Japan got hit again, and all the areas got hit again. So there is a wintertime connection. Even though these are in the tropics, I mean, it's not getting cold there. We're talking about a perturbance that happens down below the plate. Okay? So that's really, really interesting to see. If you guys wouldn't mind sharing my live stream, get the warnings out to the people that do deserve to get the warnings. Maybe somebody got the warning that I issued 5 days ago. Maybe somebody in Papua New Guinea got it. You know, 5 days is long enough for somebody to get a video on YouTube and share it, even if they don't speak English. Let's say one person there speaks English, gets the warning, gives it out to the people, takes a couple days to distribute because, of course, the area is diverse and people have to get word of mouth out. But that there could have been people in Papua New Guinea that got the warning, in which case they may have been sleeping by the door for the past few days, ready to go. And then now it hits, and it's the exact magnitude we warned for, 7.9. That's now both earthquakes we warned for. We warned for the 7.8, and we warned for the 7.9. Both hit. Now, luckily, no new deep earthquakes, which means we just have to watch for lateral pressure transfer off of this large earthquake, which is enough in itself. I mean, God, we don't need any new deep earthquakes with this. This is enough right here to push out in multiple directions. It's going to push to the west. Follow the arrows. Look where the earthquake struck right now. Let me turn down the reins. Meow, come here. Sorry, guys, my cat is riled up. The cats got into a fight today. I've got four cats. They never fight. And they went after each other this morning, right after the big one hit. And I mean within 10 minutes of the big one hitting, my cats were fighting each other, like rolling around on the floor, like, and it wasn't play. It was, and I mean, I haven't heard that in a long time. Yeah, it's okay, Wednesday. So, that all being said, it's the largest earthquake of the year. I know I keep repeating that, but I want to stress this, that the media may try to downplay it. They may ignore it because it's out here. I can tell you this, the Solomon Islands, when it hit, you should see the video from it,
First of all, there was major collapses that happened in the area. Buildings destroyed, all kinds of damage. I thought it was unpopulated, but apparently there's some pretty big cities there in the islands. Well, here, this is even probably a little bit more populated. So I'm guessing that there's probably some damage on the land, regardless of the wave. But look along the red lines. Again, the reason I'm showing this to you now is to show you these red lines where the arrows point took 7 years to figure out which way everything's going. This is the way that the pressure transfers. So look where the arrows point from here. Okay, well, the arrows are going to be excited at the middle points of each arrow. So near Guam, over here at Central Philippines, as we get up into Central Japan, also going up to the Kuril Islands, each one's going to be hit like a domino or like a checker match, jumping over checkers. It's going to be boom, 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 going right over each other over the next few days. And it's going to go out to the west, follow out past Sumatra, and go over into Asia, finally terminating in Europe. Over here, it's going to go over to the United States, guys. This is going to increase things for the Pacific in general. And I mean, it's going to take things up by a whole notch. It's another 8.0 earthquake. It's the largest earthquake of the year for the whole Pacific, for the whole planet. So if it's the largest earthquake of the year for the planet, that pretty much means we need to be on watch for the next few days. Japan, I'm not lifting your warning. Today was the final day on the warning for Japan. We're reissuing it for another 4 days. Over on the West Coast, same thing. We're reissuing it for another 4 days. Why 4 days? Well, usually it's a 2 to 3 day transit time at the most from the time that it takes to go to the West Pacific over to the East Pacific. So I'm going to give it an additional day beyond that because it's taking a little longer than normal. And again, guys, we may be jumping the gun in Oklahoma. They might still be in serious risk of another large earthquake. And it may just be taking longer than normal. There may be many factors into that as well, why it's taking longer than normal. Maybe the rotation of the Earth is playing into it in the winter months. All things that I've never looked into before that I need to start keeping track of, but there's so many different variables on this at this point that I almost need a team of people. You know, I need an institute or a laboratory or something where we could just sit here and keep track of this all, because there's so many different things that we need to be keeping track of now. But that all being said, we can know where things are striking. I mean, 5 days ago when we issued the warning, we can know where these things are going to go. It's going to go to the west. It always does. Always does. Which means if this is upstream from you right now, look downstream. Okay, look where the arrows go, and those areas are going to be hit by larger movement. It would be prudent to have those things, those areas warned. So the areas which reside along the edge of our red arrows, we need to get these people warned. So what locations need to be warned next? Well, looking to the west, you can see Sumatra, Indonesia is lacking earthquakes. Over the last 2 days, nothing. 3 days, nothing. 4 days, nothing. Going on day five, there's a single 4.5 striking at Krakatoa, Mount Krakatoa, right next to it. Okay, so, or right in the bay next to it. Well, that means that Sumatra, Indonesia is under serious pressure. I mean, take a look at it, right? Okay, so Sumatra, Indonesia is under serious pressure. Japan's under serious pressure. But Sumatra, Indonesia is our spot along the west. Look, it's going to move, and it's going to move right at the middle point, at our fulcrum point. What's the fulcrum point? It's the spot between the 4.9 all the way up here in China and going back down here to the east-southeast brings us into the cluster. And the halfway point, as I see it, unfortunately, going into the Christmas season, is here in Sumatra, Indonesia. Just by the halfway point as I see it now, and this is the last 4 days of earthquakes, we look at the last 48 hours, and it still tells the same tale. Our halfway point between the two zones is Sumatra, Indonesia, going to the west. Up to the north, our halfway point is between our two earthquakes. We have a 5.0 up in the Aleutian Island chain of Alaska. Whoops. Let me highlight that. There we go. 5.0 there, and a 5.0 here. Halfway point comes in, again, right across Japan, from Tokyo to coast of Honshu, very small little area. Okay, maybe, actually now, maybe just a little bit further north by 100 miles. let's expand it 100 miles north, actually. Let's take it from North Tokyo to Fukushima Prefecture, coast of Honshu. Right, that's adding 100 miles into it. But really, when you back it out, you see the halfway point, it goes up towards Hokkaido, right? So, oh boy, this is, it is about to be a busy weekend. Now, I told you that a couple days ago. Didn't I say that a couple days ago? I just remember saying that. I think I was that last weekend? No, that was a couple days ago. I told you guys, look, we're going to be going into this weekend, regardless of what happens with the deep earthquakes. It's going to be a busy weekend with that stuff. Then yesterday, last night, it's died out. I'm telling you guys, look, the potential for a large earthquake at this point is pretty much not there. Well, that's going forward, okay? That's going forward over the next several days. And now I would dare say that is completely canceled. Because the big one hit on day five, I was counting on it missing. I forgot I even talked about it. So counting on it missing, forgot I talked about it, but there it is. And you can go watch the update on the 12th. It's really interesting. Somebody else had to point me to it, by the way. I literally forgot I issued that warning. That's how you know, first of all, I've been going nonstop. I've been staying up 24 and 48 hours at a stint to try and cover all this over the last week and a half to 2 weeks. It's been insane. I should have left my fundraiser on. Anyways. So, it's been wild. It's the two largest earthquakes of the year have now struck in the last few days. And it's important for you, wherever you are, listen up, guys. Look where the arrows point. They point out in two directions from where this earthquake occurred. Technically three if you go up towards Japan, but we go to the west and we go to the east. Both are going to move. This is not a 50-50. This is not a guess on both sides. It's going to move on both sides. It's going to follow the arrows to the east all the way over here to Central America and South America, and it's going to flow over to the west going up towards Japan and out towards Asia. All the areas are going to be hit adjacent to this. I want you to imagine it like this. There's a jackhammering motion coming up on the underside of the plates from those deep earthquakes that happened, okay? So, the deep earthquakes that hit previously, jackhammering up on the underside of the plate, they're raised high off the globe. If you're a new viewer here, the higher these are off the planet, the deeper they are into the Earth. So you can see them. I'm waving them around here, okay? All right, those are the deep earthquakes that put new pressure on top of the 7.8, 8.0 that hit previously in the Solomon Islands. Solomon Islands is just about 800 miles east of where this current earthquake swarm is now. So Solomon Islands, like over here, okay, 800 miles. So the deep earthquakes, jackhammering up on the underside of the plate, displace large portions of the plate based upon the size of the deep earthquakes. And the more deep earthquakes we get, the more movement we get on the plate above. Well, that led now to two different sets of 7.9, 8.0 earthquakes in the last week and a half, the last 9 days. Okay, now that's going to press outwards. It doesn't just stop there. I mean, you can't just jackhammer up on the underside of a plate the size of the West Pacific and not have it compensate out in the other areas nearby. And I'm quoting my fingers there when I say nearby, because nearby is a relative term when you're talking about something this big. So we're talking about areas up in Japan, over in Sumatra, over in Asia, going over to Europe. That's how far of an area that's going to be displaced off this shallow, large movement. Same with up across Alaska and over to the United States. Following our arrows directly across, look where our fracture zones. You see these? They look like rungs on a ladder going east and west or left and right on the screen. And there's several of them. These are fracture zones that go all across the entire Pacific. Well, we found that pressure transfers when there's a big earthquake, like over here in Papua New Guinea. It's going to put pressure immediately out to the east. And what's the first thing it's going to hit? It's going to hit all of these east and west fracture zones. And look where it goes. Follow it over. Where does it go? It goes into Central America, right at the south tip of Central America, south of Guatemala. South Mexico, south of Guatemala, going down into Central America itself, like near Panama. So it's a pretty big area that's covered there. And we should see an excitement that occurs south of Guatemala going east towards Panama in the next few days. And it'll be a noteworthy excitement. So right now we're just looking at fives that happen there, right? So it should be either swarms of fives or a few single sixes at the least. May even be equal, we've seen in the past, equal size movement that strikes east and west. That hasn't been happening lately, though. So, you know, the rule of thumb that's been applying for the last few years hasn't applied in the past few earthquakes, guys. Now, I don't know if that's due to them not reporting it, or is it due to some kind of new event going on down here that's playing in with those deep earthquakes. See, the difference here now in the past few months is the rash of deep earthquakes. We used to only deal with a few at a time, like three, spread out across the Pacific, not 11 or 20 or 25 like we saw in the past month. So, with that amount of deep movement, I don't know what to expect. It's the, like I told you 2 weeks ago, it's the first time I've ever seen this many deep earthquakes in one stint, so I don't know what to make of it. Well, now we know what to make of it. It resulted in two 8.0 earthquakes, the largest earthquakes of the year, right? I mean, can I get an amen from everybody in chat who's been here that it's now we know what the result of that many deep earthquakes is? The largest earthquakes to result in the areas where the deep earthquakes occurred. I mean, it's not like they're spreading out from that spot. The spots where all those deep earthquakes occurred, nearly, I'd say at least 18, more like 20 of the deep earthquakes occurred between Papua New Guinea, South Indonesia, and Fiji, where our letter D is over here to the east. So between these two areas, we've seen nothing but deep earthquakes. Then the deep earthquakes stop, and like my video said 5 days ago, as soon as that stops, give it a little bit, and then it's like, boom, it all catches up at once and hits. And that's exactly what's happened now. But it's not going to stop there, because it's now punched and hit. It's going to spread out like breaking a windshield. But it's going to follow those fault zones, which are marked with the red lines. And it's going to go out in all directions, like a fracture in a windshield, or a fracture in a piece of stone, or a fracture in ice, or a fracture in anything rigid. Now, geologists and seismologists used to think that these areas weren't fully connected like they are shown on this map. And they didn't think that earthquakes progressed along these lines. They thought earthquakes stayed localized and that maybe caused some displacement in nearby areas like 100 miles away. Not like this. This is 700 miles away, 800, almost 800 miles away, 1,200 kilometers away from the previous large earthquake 9 days ago, the 7.8. And so when that 7.8 hit, then that led me to issue the warning on the 12th, which now expired today with the new earthquake hitting. That's going to all happen again. This sucker's going to push to the west. The only thing is there's no new deep earthquakes. No new jackhammering motion up on the underside of the plate so far. Which means that the earthquake that strikes to the west over in Sumatra and that strikes up in Japan at each of these middle points here is going to be less than, most likely less than, the 7.9 that's striking now. So our potential to go up from the 7.9 is less than our potential to go below. So we're going to see lesser earthquakes strike over in Sumatra, over towards Europe. It's going to fan out. We'll go from sevens to sixes, out to fives, out to fours, and maybe even down to threes and twos once we get out to the mid-Atlantic. Or the other option is that we'll see more like a seven or an upper six strike in Sumatra, Indonesia, again at our middle point here. And then we'll go west, and that'll lose a little bit more steam. It'll be like a upper five, and we may have to go back into Nepal again. We'll get into Nepal later on today, but that'll push back into Europe and, again, raise things back in Europe. You'll see this go from fours back to fives in Europe because of this eight all the way over here in the West Pacific. So, ultimately, it's going to go, you know, sevens, sixes, fives, fours out towards Europe, and it'll go pretty much the same thing over in the East Pacific, but it'll start on the West Coast most likely with a six, and then it'll go sixes, fives, fours, threes as we go to the east. Now, there's some people that are talking about this in California. I don't want to raise too much alarm on this, but I do have to mention it. Let's go ahead and open up the USGS last day's worth of earthquakes, 0.0 and greater. And I'm going to show you something on the map here that might stand out to you. I don't know if you're, you know, take a look at the map again, guys. Do you see anything standing out here? Do you? You see a huge stack of earthquakes here that won't even fit on the screen? All right. That stack of earthquakes is happening at Mammoth Mountain Volcano in Eastern California, right along the Nevada border. And I talked about this in my update last night, that since the 6.5 and 5.0 struck on the West Coast this past week, the largest earthquake in the United States for the year, by the way, that there's some building stress between Oklahoma and the 6.5 on the coast. Okay? And I said that that's leading to a pressure buildup in the area that could release in a large earthquake. And I said that last night. And I talked about the potential of the swarm in Oklahoma carrying on. And since last night, that actually occurred. Just moderately. 2.5, 2.8, not a big deal. But in between there, look at the swarm that re-broke out at Mammoth Mountain since I did my update last night. Okay? It's huge. It's huge. So, why is a big swarm breaking out there right now? Well, there's pressure trapped between the Gorda Escarpment, where our red arrow is here off the coast, and the Oklahoma fracking operations, where our small swarm is occurring. And in between there is one thing and one thing alone. The edge of the Craton. The western edge of the Craton. Going up to Yellowstone, going down to West Texas at the pumping operations, right through Colorado, right through Utah. And pressure has pretty much been trapped in this area, I think. Not just I think, I know at this point, because it's exciting. Mammoth Mountain. Mammoth Mountain. Look, it's a ski resort, but it's a volcano. And if you go pull the coordinates, it takes you right in on the volcano. It's on the flanks of the volcano at the tip of the Long Valley Caldera. And longtime residents in California, they already know. But you know what? Let me go ahead and turn on display capture for you guys to see this firsthand. So I'm going to put in the coordinates. And we will just go ahead and show you what's there. For longtime viewers, you know, new people, this is for you. All right? So I'm going to bring it in here, and we're looking at from above. I can actually tilt this at an angle. Whoa. What is going on there? Well, that's a little bit too much of an angle. Okay, there we go. Okay, so take a look at it, right? Here's Mammoth Mountain. It's a ski resort. We'll click on the red triangle, which is a Smithsonian Institution marking designation. And here it is. So you can pause it and read it, but I'll just let you know. It hasn't erupted in a very long time. It, of course, is because it's a ski resort. People feel comfortable going there. But there's a swarm striking right on the flanks of it. This is an active volcanic field called the Inyo Craters. Smithsonian has a mark on that too. Inyo Craters, let me show you a few of these. The Inyo Crater Lakes, this is a volcanic butte here. These are obsidian domes that rise out of the ground, obviously, but the obsidian is a volcanic glass. And so these are called glass flows, even though they don't really look like glass. I mean, you could get in here and probably find some incredible pieces of obsidian that are glass. But look at it. It rises 300 feet off the desert or forest floor. And that's just one example. It's called Obsidian Dome. That's the name of it. All right. So that's just one example of many. It goes all the way down through the Long Valley. And we have volcanoes all throughout here. So if you're familiar with the area in California, you already know this. And some of the volcanoes are fresh within the past several hundred to a few thousand years, putting off lava flows that are barely even weathered or covered in sand. Okay, so that's going on right now. In other words, a swarm is striking in a volcanically prone area on the flanks of a supervolcano. This is Mono Lake Supervolcano up to the north. Mammoth Mountain is actually part of the Mono Supervolcano. Now, they wouldn't really admit that because they don't like calling this a supervolcano. They don't want people knowing California has a supervolcano at its border. But it is. The past blast size, radius, indicate, I mean, it's on the smaller size of supervolcanoes. Like, is probably half the size of Yellowstone. Let's get a measurement on this. How wide is the caldera on this? Yeah, it's about half the size of Yellowstone. So, you know, I mean, it's big, it's huge, and it's blown out in the past, and there's other volcanoes all around it to prove that the whole area goes into upheaval from time to time. And I believe it goes into upheaval when pressure gets trapped in here. And luckily, we're not talking about the threat of an eruption, I don't think. But I've been wrong before. Interestingly enough. So, guys. Whoa. The water just came on in my bathroom. That's weird. Oh, it's a cat. The cat just turned on the faucet in the bathroom. Oh, it's like one of those creepy movies. Okay, all right. Well, that's not creepy. That's not Kitty. The kitty's creeping. That's funny. Okay. My heart skipped a beat. All right. I don't believe in that kind of stuff. All right. Anyways, word up to my people. The largest earthquake of the year struck over in the West Pacific. We're looking for increased activity in the United States, over in Japan, over in Papua New Guinea. It's a big deal. You should be concerned at this point. The two largest earthquakes of the year have struck within the last week and a half. This, by anybody's standards, and I mean any emergency planner, any professor, any geologist, any seismologist, you tell them, hey, in the last week, the two largest earthquakes of the year have struck, and they seem to be, you know, centering around an area in the West Pacific that had a whole bunch of deep earthquakes and some volcanic eruptions. There may be something going on over there. I don't want to hear anybody downplay this as not significant. So it is significant, especially for the people over here. Look, I can understand if you're removed a world away up in Minnesota, in the middle of Canada, you know, you're not really in a warned area. It might seem a little far away and not really matter. But for the people over here, there's millions of people, guys. And the last few earthquakes that struck killed hundreds of people each time because they didn't get the warnings. Look, it's tropical there. They could sleep outside for the night in a hammock, okay? I mean, you know, they get the warning. They don't have to be in their brick cinder house, you know, that's going to fall in at the first shaking of an 8.0 earthquake. So it's not like the middle of the winter here where if people have to go outside or sleep by the door, you're going to be running out in the sub-zero temperatures. So winter for them over there is a big deal, not that big of a deal. So, in other words, we can get the warnings out to these people, and they can have plenty of time. They had 5 days to prepare for the earthquake to strike in Papua New Guinea. 5 days to prepare for the world's largest earthquake in the last year. And it is the world's largest earthquake this year. So they had 5 days to prepare. If they didn't get the warning, I don't know why. It's just because maybe language barrier or censorship. I do know for certain. How many people are in here right now? 513? Okay. 513 people, please listen. And I'm not exaggerating. You can verify with any one of the people in my chat room right now. My moderators are witness to this. I issued a warning many weeks ago, now a couple months ago, over in Italy. A deep earthquake struck down below Italy, a 5.8 deep earthquake. Not that big of a deal, that one. But that was going to cause a larger earthquake. So I issued a warning for up to a 7.8 to strike in Italy. And then the next day, after I issued the warning, Italy got hit with a near 7.8. I believe it was a 7.2, and then they downgraded it even more. But regardless, a 7 hit the next day after we issued the warning. The people in Italy were happy. The people who did get the warning were happy. And they took to the news. They mentioned me on BBC. They, you know, gave me a shout out and all this other stuff for getting the warning out. And they actually slept in their cars and they were sleeping by the door just in case, you know, to run out. And then the earthquake hit. Well, now it's come to my attention that the people who live in Italy have come under harassment by official sources from the Italian government that are telling them that they are not allowed to share or translate my earthquake forecasts, because it's illegal to forecast earthquakes in Italy. I take another sip of my coffee while you ponder that for a second. Now, that being said, I was going to go over to Italy. I was planning on going over to Italy to teach anyone, publicly, free, no charge, professional, layman, anyone, how to forecast an earthquake. I was going to give a public presentation there. How to forecast an earthquake. I don't foresee how that can happen if they have a law in the country that says it's illegal to forecast earthquakes and that people are being harassed by official sources in Italy for doing that, for just repeating what I'm saying, translating what I'm saying into Italian. That is absolutely crazy. That's beyond crazy. It's unacceptable, and I cannot believe it. I do believe it. For people who are listening internationally, you don't know I'm being sarcastic. I am outraged. I don't even know what to say. So, we got to change that. I can't do anything about it. If you're in Italy, you've got to change that. You need to immediately change your laws. You have to change your laws because I can't come there to teach you, and I'd have to do a, what, I have to go to Switzerland? Do we have to do it right at the Swiss border with a megaphone? Like South Korea into North Korea, I can sit there on the other side with a big old set of speakers and a big screen, and we can broadcast it into the people in Italy who aren't free to do earthquake forecasting? Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Hey, people in Italy, listen. Lawmakers in Italy, people who are in charge in Italy, look, I put my reputation on the line. I put everything on the line to get the warning out to the people in Italy a day before the big one hit. Look, if I was wrong, that's egg on my face. And I take it serious that if I'm wrong, people, you know, go outside and sleep in their car and nothing happens and, they, you know, they get mad at me or whatever and they, you know, never listen again. So I take it real serious. And this is the case of, again, this is going to be in translation, so people in Italy might not get it. But we have a saying here in the United States that applies to good people being treated bad, or people that are trying to help that get treated bad, and it's called no good deed goes unpunished. All right? And that's what I feel like is going on here right now with the people, with the government in Italy. You'd think they'd be happy that somebody is issuing a warning the day before so that they can have a full day's warning for what's going on any given day. And that you think they'd want to know. But instead, they're actively threatening people and shutting them down and saying it's illegal to do it and all this other stuff. Well, look, I wanted to come over and teach you guys for free. The professionals show you, just like, you know, you can take it or leave it. You don't have to use it. But, you know, I don't want to get arrested. It's insane. So you got to change the law, whatever the law is. I have to look it up and find out what the law is. But I mean, listen to my voice. I went from being calm, cool, and collected to being outraged, because man, I just can't believe that, okay, look, science, man, science, the enlightenment, you're gonna imprison the person who discovers a telescope? You're gonna imprison, oh wait, they did that, that's right. Oh wait, that's right. They're the people who imprisoned the guy with the telescope, aren't they? That's right, Galileo Galilei, I think that's what his name was. I don't quite remember. Don't quite remember the whole story of Galileo Galilei. Oh, that's right. Oh, yeah, I do. Hey, I don't quite remember that whole story of Copernicus. Oh, yeah, that's right. And I'm not saying I'm that smart. I'm not even 1/10. I'm not even 1/100. I am a pusillanimous little germ of a microbe on the fingertip of Galileo. But that being said,
if that pusillanimous little germ on the fingertip of Galileo figures something out, it shouldn't be denied, it shouldn't be made illegal, and it surely shouldn't be denied by other scientists when you can put an arrow on a map and follow it like a dang roadmap at this point. So which is it going to be? Do the people in Italy want to know when an earthquake is going to strike? Or are you guys going to freaking repeal that law so you can figure it out and somebody can show you? Which do you want? Repeal the law? Allow dutchsinse in to teach you? Or keep your law and stay in ignorance? And rely on a guy on YouTube to broadcast it around the world to get to you through third-party means, through censorship and everything else? Are you going to stand for that? Or are you just going to get up and make a change? I almost demand that you do, but I don't want to influence anything in your country. You got to make the decision. If you think it should be illegal to forecast earthquakes, then so be it. I won't do it for Italy unless you want to. I don't want to get you in trouble. You know what I mean? Like, if you go share my video, you know, next thing you know, it's like knock, knock, knock on the front door. Excuse me, you shared this dutchsinse video. Please come with us. And you're like, dude, for earthquake forecasting, they're like, yeah, we don't want anybody to know. Are you serious? Are you serious? I sound like Paul Bagley. Kim Jong-un is drunk. A drunk Kim Jong-un. And on that note, I'm going to go get another cup of coffee, take a break for a second. I'll be back in a few. If you're just now tuning in, the largest earthquake of the year has occurred in Papua New Guinea inside of our warned area. We issued a warning on the 12th. 5 days ago, and we issued the warning for 5 days for Papua New Guinea. So here we are on day five, and it did hit. Now, luckily, again, one more time summing up, there hasn't been any new deep earthquakes to add more to the punch. That's good news. The bad news is this is going to spread out. Like a fracture in a windshield, it's going to go out in all directions following these arrows. So it'll go out to the east, it'll go to the north, and it'll go to the west. It's going to excite things to the east, north, and west. But the east, it's going to take it straight out across our arrows over towards Central America. So people in Central America, look where the arrows point. Okay, we go right along our fracture zone here. We go north of our Leviathan. That takes us in here again into south of Guatemala, going down into Central America. This is the Galapagos, east to Ecuador. Okay, this is a pretty large section here. We're going to have to watch. It's a big area, and this is a big earthquake, so it's going to send a lot of pressure to the east. The excitement zones to the east could be anywhere from south of Guatemala, going to Ecuador, picking up back down south at our other arrow. You see this arrow here? Okay, now I dare say that the lesser movement will be going down to the south. I sure hope it will be going, lesser movement will be going down to the south, but mostly it's going to go to the east, also going to go to the west and north. It's not a 50-50 split, guys. It's three areas that it's going to go to in the next few days. And the magnitudes, as we get out towards the west, should lose a little momentum from the 7.9. So it should lose a little steam as it transfers across these areas. But, I mean, if it loses a few points, let's say it goes down a half magnitude, that's still a 7. So, you know, let's say it goes down a whole magnitude, that's still an upper 6. Big enough to knock down houses over there. So again, we need to get the people in Japan on board. We need to get the people in Taiwan on board. Look at our points where the arrows point to, our central fulcrum points in these silent zones. Keep in mind, Japan supposedly had a 5.8 or a 4.8, 4.9 earthquake a day ago. Okay, so one 4.9 up in there and a couple fours. So really, when you look at our fulcrum points, they stand out. They're the halfway points between the zones that have moved. As we go over west, you start getting into Asia, and you have a huge, vast area that's set to be hit. It's going to all be hit after the West Pacific, though. So first things first, Japan, Sumatra, Philippines, Taiwan, Guam. In that order, most likely. So Japan's already primed. It's ready to go. It's right on the east-northeast edge of the rim. Pressure's going to the east-northeast. Guam will be hit along the way. Taiwan over to the west, similar size movement. Here's something else really quick. I don't want to get too confusing here, but you see the arrows here, right? Okay, when an earthquake strikes on one side of the arrows, the other side of the arrows right here moves with similar size. and it happens back and forth like a tennis match. So, for instance, right here, if you see a 5.0 where the two arrows meet, then you might want to watch, not just might, you will want to watch over to the west for a similar sized earthquake. It might be a 4.9 or a 5.1 or 5 itself. You'll see similar sized earthquakes strike on both sides within a few hours of each other to a day at the most. Compensation movement on both sides here, very seldomly, and I mean very seldomly, striking in between these spots. Hardly ever. Hardly ever. I don't want to say it never happens, but hardly ever. It's mostly on both sides of here, and it'll be equidistantly spaced as well. So not only equidistantly timed and in equal magnitudes, but it'll be equally spaced. It's amazing that that happens, but you can see it happen. So, and it always happens after it gets pushed. And what pushes this area where the letter D is in this whole area? Well, of course, what pushes it is the activity coming from the east-southeast, because pressure does transfer around the globe in certain directions. Every week, every month, every year, for the last 7 years I've been watching, I can't believe they denied it. But there it is. I can't believe that they've made earthquake forecasting illegal in Italy, but there that is. Man, where are we? I am in like the twilight zone of bizarro world. This is like some tinfoil hat conspiracy theory crap over in Italy. What do you guys, they're chewing on tinfoil over in Italian parliament. The tinfoil chewers. They're not even wearing the hats. You guys, you're supposed to wear your tinfoil hats, not chew them. And I'm talking to Italian parliament, not talking to the actual Italian people. To the Italian people at dutchsinse, Terremoto 3D International, I am talking to you and I am saying tanto amore. But you guys got to do something. You got to actually stand up and get that law repealed, because you got to be able to forecast earthquakes yourself. I'm trying to teach you. What good is having a teacher if you can't practice what I'm teaching? What am I supposed to do? Sit here from a throne in St. Louis, Missouri, and constantly issue warnings for people around the world? Or can we finally train some professionals in these countries to start forecasting for their own countries? Or at least train the people so they can go look themselves? Look, hey man, look, I understand you don't want professionals doing it for pay, or you don't want to be on the legal hook for issuing. Okay, fine, teach the average Joe to do it. They can do YouTube videos like I'm doing. And say, you know, look, take it for what it's worth. I'm an average citizen. This is what I figured out. You can watch these areas or not. Take it at your own risk. This is YouTube. It is what it is. And just put it out that way. But to make it illegal or to give people a hard time, you're free? Are you guys free? Do they have a constitution in Italy? Do they? I don't know. It's a legitimate question. Are you free? I don't know if you're free or not. I mean, I'm not trying to be disrespectful. I am not trying to be disrespectful. I'm asking. I need to go look it up, right? Here, let me go look it up. Let's turn on display capture. Let's go look it up together. Does Italy have a const... Oh, look, it's a top. It's a top. Constitution of... Look, you got a Wikipedia. All right, where do we go? Where do we want to go? Okay, Italy is a democratic republic founded on work. Sovereignty belongs to the people and is exercised by the people in forms within the limits of the Constitution. The republic recognizes and guarantees inviolable rights of the person as an individual in the social groups where human personality is expressed. Hold on. They're violating their own constitution. Hold on. They are violating their own constitution by their law preventing earthquake forecasting. Because earthquake forecasting would definitely... We are a social group. You can't say I'm not a social group when I'm on social media. So we are a social group. We're social groups where human personality is expressed. Are we not expressing our own human personality by coming to our own conclusions on where we think earthquakes are going to strike next? Wow. All citizens have equal social dignity and equal before the law, without distinction of sex, race, language, religion, political opinion, personal and social conditions. You need to add science onto that. Scientific discoveries. Since you've been... since the Italian system is guilty of imprisoning Galileo, you might want to address science in this, guys. The Republic recognizes the right of all citizens to work and promotes those conditions which render this right. Hold on. There's another violation. Another violation because, I have a right to work. I have a right to work. This is my work. This is work, baby. I am up 48 hours on sometimes and on a stint. Right now I'm on 29 hours. I've been up 29 hours. It's a nonstop thing. And not only that, I've got the axe of death hanging over my neck on every call I make. And if I make it wrong, everybody's on me. If I get it right, well, Italian government's going to attack me. Wait. Read the next sentence. They're in violation again. Every citizen has the duty, according to personal potential and individual choice, to perform an activity or function that contributes to the material or spiritual progress of society. That's in Italy, guys. Well, isn't earthquake forecasting? I mean, isn't it a function that contributes to the material progress of society? Hello? Yes. Hello? Wow. Oh, look, Article 9. Look at this. The Republic promotes the development of cultural and scientific and technical research. No. How can you have that in your constitution and then be here? Hold on. I gotta play it. All right. I mean, there it is. I mean, okay, you got it. I mean, you got the Price is Right losing horn. That is an epic fail. That is what I call an epic fail. I'm gonna stop right there. I think I've read enough. Okay. This is what happens when I drink too much coffee. Inquiring minds want to know, and then I get an answer I don't want to see. So, all right. So your constitution is BS, right, Italy? Isn't that what it means? Or you guys just aren't going to do anything about it? I don't know, man. What, I mean, is it going to take me to say something about it? Yeah, you got to pass a new constitutional amendment that says it's okay to do scientific research of any kind. No matter who you are and no matter what you discover. Even if you're wrong. How the hell do you expect anybody to do any research if you're going to arrest them? How do you expect to find out if you're right or wrong? How are people supposed to put my earthquake forecasting methodology to the test to debunk it or prove it true? Oh, will they allow a debunking? Oh, I'm sure they'll allow a debunking, right? You know what I mean? This is frustrating. Okay. So, that all being said, we got 500 people in here, guys. I'm going off on a tangent because, again, my viewers were harassed over by the Italian government for repeating my forecasts. Now, we issued a forecast for the area over here in Papua New Guinea. I hope some of the people got that. It was issued on the 12th. They had 5 days to prepare for the largest earthquake of the year on the planet, and it hit. So, now that it hit, other areas are going to be hit. I just talked about that at length. You can rewind to see that. And that's all I've got for you right now. I'm going to jump down, get another cup of coffee, save this as a video on my channel as a new update so people can see and be up to date on what's going on. And I will be watching throughout the day today to see what else happens. We are iced in here where I'm at in St. Louis. We got a glazing of ice last night. My mom, my 72-year-old mother, just had her birthday yesterday, is trapped on the highway in rural Missouri with a state trooper and 12 cars of people that were just random strangers driving. And then it suddenly iced out of nowhere. We weren't supposed to get it till today. And they all got stuck out on the road. State troopers there, everybody. They're sitting in their cars. Just talked to them a couple hours ago. been there for 12 hours now. And they're going to be there until a salt truck is finally able to make it through these country roads to leave salt for them. It's amazing. So I'm iced in here. We've got the largest earthquake of the year going on. And I got a feeling we're not out of the woods at all. We are going to be seeing an increase in activity over the weekend. It's going to be a rock and roll weekend in the West Pacific in particular. And then in our areas that I warned, West Coast, Central America. Boy, oh boy. Okay, we'll be back in a little while. Enjoy the Yule log. Enjoy the Christmas music. It's going to be a little festive. I can change it up. I can. But we'll keep playing this for a minute. And then once this is done, I'll be switching it back up into something a little bit more contemporary. Okay? All right, guys. Word up. Peace out.